I've been asked to talk about basically the image we have as a Muslim about the Buddhism and the Buddhist community. So before I go into this topic, I would like to say a couple of things regarding what puts images into our mind, I mean psychologically. For those who study psychology, especially social psychology, they will know there are a couple of things that are really effective. The things that we read is really effective. That puts an image, some kind of a form into our minds about the other. The things that we hear, I mean, all of them have their effects on different levels. The things that we hear about the other shapes our mind and puts another image into our minds. And more effectively, the things that we see, is this is a more effective way, kind of shapes our minds and gives us a perspective about the other. And fourthly, the things that we experience, which is the most effective one, are the things that really shapes our minds and put images into our mind. And especially the things that we experience may change the other perceptions that we have. For example, we may have read or seen or heard about somebody or some people, and we had an early perception, and once we have experienced, the all other elements of perceptions that shapes our mind can be declined by experience. So therefore, the things that we read through media, this is the reality. The things that we see and watch television, and the things that we hear from those who knows something about the other and shares with us, the things that we hear again from radio and television, shapes our mind. And this is exactly what happened to the Muslim community throughout the world. And unfortunately, Buddhism was known, of course. They had some kind of image. They had some kind of a picture in their mind, like a very peaceful people and trying to preserve the world, like Imam mentioned, dedicated themselves themselves to the world peace. But all of a sudden, they are starting to hear what's going on in the southeast part, and the images changes totally. And what's going on? And this is one of the reasons why we feel the need of a dialogue between Buddhist communities. So in order to have the right perception, I think, so we have to have an experience about each other. And which is mentioned also in the Quran, in the ayah, in the verse Imam Ali has mentioned. So I'm not going to get into the details except for one thing. So God has created us with different tribes and different nations so that we get to know each other. We know each other. Lita'arufu is the word. This word, ta'aruf, is very, very sensitive, very important word. Instead, for example, God may have used, for those who know Arabic, لِتَعَالَمُ, it may mean something in some way. The difference between ta'alum and ta'aruf is that ta'alum is the things that you read through books. Ta'aruf is the things that you experience. That's why we call those who are really deep in knowledge and experience an arif in Islam. It comes from the same root. So therefore, when Allah says, when God says in Islamic tradition, so that you get to know each other, it doesn't really mean so that you should read about each other. It means you come together. You have the experience of the other, face to face, eye to eye, heart to heart, whatever it is. So that is what is actually meant with the dialogue, and this is exactly what we are trying to do over here. And people who would never come together and talk about faith, and we are here and talk about and try to understand about each other. Second point that I would like to make on this one, so there is a common misconception on general dialogue that we do, especially in interfaith dialogue. The misconception is that, so in order to have a dialogue, you have to have some kind of common ground, and you have to share something with people so that you can have a dialogue. No, this is not dialogue. In order to make a dialogue, you don't have to share anything with the other. Dialogue is this, This is within the description of our honorary president, Mr. Fethullah Gulen. It is accepting everyone for who they are. You don't have to share anything. You just get to know about the other tradition for what they are, for what they are standing for. And just dialogue is trying to learn so that you can make some kind of connection. And there is one thing, one big joke that I always share with my fellow interfaith community. At the end of the day, we say, so, I mean, we have our differences, we have our different beliefs, we have our different definitions of God and paradise and death and all these terms. So don't worry about that. When we die, we will see who is right, who is wrong. But our mission in this world is, we have to make a peaceful living. And in order to do, in order to know that, so we have to get to know each other through experience. And because books and or the things that we read or watch may be deceptive, may be not 100% telling the truth. That was the second point that I was hoping to make. And thirdly, and I would like to share my experience, two experience with the Buddhist community. Actually, 1.5 years ago, when Master Jinjie came to UN to speak over here, so I was introduced to him. So we had the first experience of the Buddhist community from Korea. For those, I mean, he's the biggest Buddhist master in Korea. He has approximately, I think, like about 20 million followers over there. It's the second largest religion in South Korea. He came over here, and we had the honor to host him. And with his words, that was the first experience of Master Jinji to have a Muslim dialogue. Or I was the first imam that he ever encountered and to talk to. In a way, it is very good. In a way, it is very sad. And obviously, he had a lot of images, and he shared the images that he had with me. And he invited me over to South Korea. I went to South Korea. And I had the honor to be a guest of him, and I stayed there for a couple of days. And through this experience, I have seen, I mean, we are human being. We are loving being, and we are hating the same thing, we are loving the same thing, and we are sharing a lot of things, even though we don't need to share anything to accept each other, to coexist in this world. But that kind of established a relationship. When you have a trusted relationship, you can build on it everything. Everything. And that kind of gave us an idea. On the way came back, and we had already an established relationship with Reverend TK. And we talked about a possibility of establishing a group of Buddhist monks and Buddhist leaders from New York and give them the Muslim experience of Turkey. And we came together last year, last summer, and I had I would like to thank you. And I think he's going to share, and I will let him share his experiences over there. But I would like to share the Muslim side of the experience over there. So especially around the time that we went, the topic was very hot, especially what's going on in the southeast part. People were wondering really what's going on. To have Buddhists before their eyes and give them the first experience was a big help. And I can they had a national television coverage too, so that was really had a very good positive effect. Even seeing it, you don't have to understand, even seeing it, those people are a human being like us, makes really the difference. So one more? 1 minute? Okay. Lastly, maybe I should just say this. Yes, there are problems that has been a lot of people are talking about. It's not in my idea between Buddhism and Islam. It is between two different type of people who are living and happen to, their traditions happen to be Buddhist and Islamic. There are a lot of aspects of it. So we cannot solve the problems abroad. We don't have the power. We don't have that power. But we can prevent the problems abroad affects us over here. we can prevent the negative effects of these problems over there affects us over here. So this is an early precaution. Because once we have a real experimental knowledge about the other, no matter what I read, no matter what other people say about Buddhism and Buddhist people, I have the first-hand experience. They cannot. I mean, I'm not affected. So this is actually an engine start for us to build a relation between two communities, to give each other a first-hand experience. If and also early prevention from the possible effects that people are experiencing abroad. Thank you. Thank you very much.